Glory to your holy name. Here we are, Jesus, tonight. We commit our spirit into your hands, Psalms 31. Hallelujah, in verses 5. We commit our soul. We lift it up unto you who dwells in the heavens, Psalms 25 and 1. We present our bodies now unto you as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which our reasonable service. Romans 12 and verses 1. God, I give you glory tonight. We give ourselves to you. We give ourselves away. We give it up, Holy Spirit. Take us. Divinely dispose of us. Use us tonight for your glory, for your credit, for your praise. Hallelujah. For thine's the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Matthew 6 and verse 13. Lord, as you hang on the cross in Luke 23, verse 43, Jesus, as you look down at the foot of your bloody cross, as you, the Savior, were suffering so our sins could be forgiven. You watched a group of soldiers, Roman soldiers, who just played games at the foot of your cross. They gambled for your blood-soaked garments, fulfilling Psalms 22 and 18 as David, who was a prophet, looked through the telescope of time and this messianic passage declared what would happen on that day. They would cast lots for his garments. They would play games while he was hanging on the cross, sitting there. And the Bible, Lord God, you said in Matthew 27 and 36, verse 35, Lord God, they sit there and cast lots playing games. And Lord, verse 36 said they just watched. They just looked at you while they played games, and you were shedding your blood for the forgiveness of their sins. And in Luke 23, 43, you announced from that cross, looking at those playing games, Lord God, those that were speaking against you, even as Psalms 22, amen, David prophesied that they would be like the bulls of Bashan, the big, strong bulls, and how they would speak out and how they would attack even with their words. And Lord God, Jesus, you from that cross said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Holy Ghost, tonight we thank you for adversaries. Thank you for enemies. We praise you for those you permit to persecute us. For Lord God, though they don't know what they do, we do. And when we do, we can say as Jesus did from the cross, Father, I forgive them. They don't know what they do. But God, anytime you get ready to use a vessel, you allow enemies to attack. Anytime you get ready to touch a life and anoint it and schedule it strategically by your spirit to be used, hallelujah, as your vessel of honor, you always allow the lions to roar and the Philistines to shout and the voices to speak and the things, hallelujah, of the adversary to come and speak. And Lord, I stand here tonight. For I know by you, Holy Spirit, I know in the Spirit, even as Elijah, Lord God, or Elisha, hallelujah, went with his servant in the Spirit and heard what went on, though he weren't there in the flesh. And Lord, I lift my hands tonight, hallelujah. And Lord, the voices that have even spoke against your word, the voices that have spoke against your anointing and your anointed one, Holy Spirit, we say, Father, we forgive them, for they know not what they do. But we do, and we're excited, hallelujah, because what shall we say at these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Romans 8 and verses 31, I give you glory tonight. God, even Paul the apostle said in 2 Thessalonians or 2 Timothy 5 verses 16 and 17, at first no man stood with me at my first answer, but all men went against me, hallelujah. And I pray God not lay it to their charge, but Lord, he said, notwithstanding in this, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known unto the Gentiles of the sinners, hallelujah. And I was delivered out of the mouth of a lion. I thank you tonight, God, when no man will stand with us, you will. When no man will be there, Jesus will, hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Our hope's not in flesh. We're not the circumcision that worship God in the flesh, but rather in the spirit, and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. We worship you tonight, and I thank you, Spirit of God. The lion's mouth will be closed. It will be shut. Hallelujah. Before I came to this pulpit tonight, and even before I got to this church, even 3 days ago, God spoke to me something and showed me in the spirit. I saw a lion's mouth open, but I saw a lion's mouth being shut. For Daniel 6, 21 and 22, thank you, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Daniel cried out after spending a night with lions. Hallelujah, where he was thrown to. And he said, "Live, O King, for the God whom I serve has sent his angel this night, and he has shut the lion's mouth." Holy Ghost, I thank you. What the enemy has sent to devour us will only serve to develop us to be used by you. And we give you glory. Come on, somebody. Look at your neighbor. Say, don't take the persecution personally. Don't take what it is the enemy is dishing out against you personally. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. It's not you that he attacks. It's the anointed one. Hallelujah. And when God gets ready to anoint a vessel, he allows attacks. For God said in his word, I don't even know why I say what I say, but Holy Spirit, I follow you. You said in your word in 2 Samuel 5 in verses 17, when the Philistines heard that David had been anointed, they began to seek him. Holy Spirit, you know you've anointed a vessel, because enemies start coming, enemies start speaking, things start happening. But God, tonight we praise you. And as we praise you, we forgive things that has been said. Lord, I forgive those that have said stuff even in this room. They've said it somewhere around this altar. They've said it somewhere down that aisle. They said it somewhere out there in the foyer. Holy Ghost, you warned last Tuesday night those that would get on the phone this week. I forgive those that's been on the phone. Says the Spirit of God, Holy Ghost, and I release them, for they know not what they do. And I pray, oh God, lay it not to their charge, and have mercy upon them, and give wisdom to those whom your Spirit dwells in. That, Holy Spirit, you're not bound to religion, you're not bound to a denominational name. And Holy Spirit, you don't choose vessels according to that. Hallelujah. Put up a Sunday to be, for you said in Isaiah chapter 30 in verses 2, my covering is of the Spirit of the Lord. Holy Spirit, you're my covering. Holy Ghost, you're anointed. And I give you glory tonight. And I have all right to declare, thus says the Spirit of God. By him who was crucified on the cross and shed his blood for the remission of my sins, who called me, who ordained me, set me apart for his glory, and chose me from a furnace of an affliction. Isaiah 48 in verse 16, my afflictions, my sufferings, Holy Spirit, that is my covering, that is my anointing, that's where I have come from. Forgive those that speak, that don't know our roots, that forget and don't understand where we come from. But Holy Ghost, we release them tonight. I'll just say it openly. Somebody, you need to lift your hands right now, and you need to forgive Sister Sandpaper. You need to forgive Brother Bucket Mouth. You need to forgive all those lions. You need to forgive all those Philistines. You need to let them go, because if you don't forgive them, you'll begin to resemble them. Who you don't forgive, you'll eventually resemble. That's why hurt people hurt people. If you don't let them go. And here's how you do. You go to the cross. You see Jesus saying, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They don't know what they're doing, but you should by now. That's how I can forgive, because I know what's being done. Come on, somebody. They don't know what they're doing. They think they're doing what God said. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Somebody's looking at me like a deer in the headlights. Come on, somebody. Who you been talking to, Holy Ghost? In Luke chapter 17, somebody say, what a good word for 2017. In verses 3, amen, Jesus is teaching his disciples, and he said, if your brother trespasses against you 7 times in a day and repents, you're to turn 7 times and forgive him. Come on, somebody. Somebody shout 7 times in a day, not just 1 time, not just 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. Hallelujah. Anybody hear Holy Ghost? Ephesians 5:32, the Bible said, be tender-hearted, Come on, somebody. Toward one another, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, forgave you. Somebody say, for Christ's sake. Somebody say it again, for Christ's sake. Somebody shout, forgive them, for Christ's sake. Release them at the altar, at the cross, for Christ's sake. Christ is not his first name, and neither is it his last. It's his identity. It means he's the anointed one. He's the Messiah. He's the sent one. Somebody shout, for the sake of the anointing, forgive them. For the sake of the anointing, let them go. Ephesians 4:32. Somebody shout, don't rob yourself of the anointing. Don't rob yourself of the power and the touch of God in your life. Come on, hallelujah. When somebody hurts you, don't hurt them back. Come on, take your hurt to the cross. Come on, take your pain to the cross. Because Psalms 22 and 16, he said, they pierced my hands and my feet. Somebody shout, that meant all the pains you would ever know, whether it be physically, mentally. Come on, somebody, whatever it was, spiritually, whatever the pain is, I'm telling you, he took it in his body on this cross. Hallelujah. He who himself took our sins in his body on the cross. Come on, somebody, died so we could live righteous. By whose stripes we were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Somebody say, what a gift. Forgiven. That's what forgiveness is for. It's for giving. It don't mean they deserve it, but somebody shout, it's a gift that you got to learn to give. And the only way you can have power to do it is when you get a revelation of his cross and you realize, you see that Jesus hanging there. Look at your neighbor, say, it was your sins and mine that nailed him to the cross. It just weren't them Roman soldiers. We were them Roman soldiers sitting at the foot of his cross, him bleeding and dying for us. It was us playing games with his grace. It was us playing games with his spirit. It was us that nailed him there. Come on, somebody. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? It was my sin. It was your sin. For we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. We were then Roman soldiers casting lots with his blood-soaked garments in him while we're just watching. Looks down and says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Wow. Holy Ghost showed me that one day. He said, son, they don't know, but you should. Somebody say, when somebody's attacking me, come on, say it. When somebody's attacking me, when somebody's hurting me, when somebody's abused me, come on, I'm gonna tell you, hallelujah, God may allow some things, but he's not the author of what's been allowed. Come on, he's not to be blamed. Psalms 18 and 30 said, as for God, his way's perfect. I'm preaching to somebody, even as a child, you were abused. You still carry around the load of that luggage, come on, somebody, from the past. And if you don't let that person go, you'll resemble that person. Again, that's why hurt people hurt people. People can be abused in their childhood and hold that grudge and that hatred harbored in their heart and not release it at the foot of his cross at an altar. And Pastor Jamie, they begin to resemble that person. And they can't imagine, how in the world did I turn out like this? How in the world am I doing to others what was done to me? Why? Here's why. You didn't forgive them. Come on, somebody. Well, preacher, I don't feel like it. You don't know what they did. No, I don't know what they done, but I know what he did. In John 19 and 30, it's finished. Come on, somebody. If he forgave you, you've got to forgive them by faith. You know what the disciples, you know what the disciples said in Luke 17 and 5? After Jesus told them, if your brother sins against you seven times in a day and repents, turn again and forgive him seven times. You know what they prayed? Verse 5 is Luke 17. Lord, increase our faith. God, give me faith. Somebody say, faith to forgive. I didn't say you're supposed to feel like doing it. But for Christ's sake, for the sake of the anointing, for the sake of that today's touch, that tangible touch. Let thy hand be upon the man of thy right hand, who you made strong for yourself. Psalms 80, verse 17. Somebody say, let your hand be. It ain't enough to just have yesterday's touch. I want today's touch. Be present here. God, I don't want to lose your touch just because somebody touched me. Hallelujah. And I couldn't let them go. I couldn't release them. Hallelujah. Somebody shout, tonight's a release date. I know 2 nights ago we had a Holy Ghost jailbreak in here, a praise jailbreak. But I'm telling you tonight, God says the heavens are going to open. And that's been held back and kept back from your life, that you've wondered at his wonders about, why it didn't happen and why God ain't answering. Tonight, God's giving you the reason. This will close the heavens up. This will keep his touch back. Come on, somebody. This will hinder his Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Lift your hands and say, Lord, give me faith to forgive them. You know where you find faith to forgive anybody? Somebody say at the cross. Come on, see him there in Luke 23:43. See him there saying they don't know what they do. But Father, I forgive them. Hey, some stuff I done when I was sinning in the world, if I'd understood what I was doing, I wouldn't have did it. Come on, anybody breathing? Anybody still here? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank God. Jesus looked down and said, no, he don't deserve it. I can't forgive him. In that case, there'd be nobody saved tonight. Because don't none of us deserve his mercy. Don't none of us deserve that statement, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And in Luke 6:37, Jesus said, if you don't forgive others their sins, I will not forgive yours. I know Matthew 12 says there's an unpardonable sin. It's called blaspheming the Holy Ghost. But there's a second unpardonable sin. If you don't forgive others when they sin against you, come on, somebody. God says, I can't forgive you. Somebody shout, you can't go to heaven harboring hatred. You can't go to heaven. Sin ain't going to enter those gates. Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, by the Spirit of God tonight, there's a liberty that only can come in your life when you say, Father, by faith, because of the cross and what he said on the cross, I forgive them, for they know not what they do. Let me tell you what they do, since some of us has forgot what they do, though they don't know what they do. When God wants to use you, he allows, though he don't author, but yet he allows stuff to come at you and come against you. Some of you, it started as soon as you got out of the womb. Some of you, it started even in your childhood, even in your teenage years. Stuff that happened to you and stuff you had to go through, and watch marriages and separations and families. And some of you are adults, some of you in your 30s and 40s, and it still bothers you what happened between your mother and father, and stuff that happened to you that violated your innocence, even as a young child, by people you trusted that should have loved you and you should have been safe with. Come on, somebody. And some of you was damaged because of words that were spoke over you and said to you. Come on, even by so-called Christians who were cursing Christians when they cursed you and spoke things negative about you. Hallelujah. And demeaned you and demised you. Hallelujah. Not even knowing what they were doing. And it affected you the rest of your life. But somebody shout tonight, you got to let them go. I can't get somebody forward until I get you back. Somebody say back and forth. I got to get you back first. I got to bring you back to some places in the past that's been discarded, that you've just covered up. I remember one night I was standing at a sink of dirty water. Been married, I don't know, me and Lynn's been married close to 22 years. This was probably 5-6 years. But she'd been praying some, and God had anointed me that night with the spirit of a dishwasher. Brother Scott, that was for dishwasher days, you know. Hey, man, we just turn the button, put the stuff in there. Thank God. Hallelujah. Thank you for him, Lord. Hey, man, I'm telling you, I'd rather reach in a trash can. I just installed a toilet the other day. Come on, somebody. I put a new John in. Praise God. I'd rather do something like that and have to, I don't know why, but than have to reach in dirty dishwater. I don't know why. Might be because I don't know. But anyhow,
Amen. And I remember I stuck my hands in that old dirty dishwater, let that old dirty water been standing in there for a while, and all them dirty dishes almost looked like some of that stuff was moving, like it done come alive, like it crawling in there, just gooey. Somebody say, I'm telling you, it was nasty. And I'm about to throw up while I'm like, oh God, hallelujah, oh Jesus, oh man. And I'm sitting there and I'm letting it out, and I'm putting some clean water in, and I'm washing them dishes, and hallelujah. All of a sudden I heard the Holy Ghost speak these words. He said, that dirty dishwater you just let out, amen, is what your spirit looks like to me tonight. I immediately wanted to say, God, I've been preaching revivals for you. Lord, you've been doing miracles through me. God, I've been doing this for a long time now, serving you. Like somehow I got points with God because I've been in a pulpit. Like somehow, amen, the full counsel of God don't apply to me because I happen to be a preacher. I believe to us it even more applies. Hello? You think Donald Trump's going to have to answer to God when he gets to heaven? If Jesus is his Lord when he leaves this earth. Come on, somebody. Amen. All of us are going to answer to him. But let me tell you something, preacher. The position we walk in, though the world may never know who you are, come on, somebody. We dealing with eternity. We dealing with souls. We dealing with people's eternal soul. Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, that's the highest position you can walk in this world. And the Holy Ghost grieved in me and convicted me, and he says, you've never forgave your earthly father. I said, well, Lord, I thought I did. The Holy Ghost spoke back, and he said, you didn't, or I wouldn't be telling you this. You still have something in your heart. I began to weep right in that dishwater I was putting in. And I said, Lord, just as clean as this water is, I'm putting in this thing where I've let out that dirty water. I said, oh God, create within me a clean heart, oh God. Renew a right spirit within me. Psalms 51:10. And I could feel the hurt. I didn't even think it was there. But I started feeling that hurt come up. I started feeling that stuff come up in me. It started coming up like oil separating in water. And I said, oh God, it is still there, ain't it? And I began to weep, and I had me a flash of faith. Whew. I could see Jesus on the cross, and I could hear him saying, they don't know what they do. This is why I forgive them. And the Holy Ghost spoke to me and says, son, you can't hold a grudge. You can't hold the hatred against somebody that did whatever they did. They didn't know what they were doing. But don't you realize I used the hard places. I used the hurt places. Hallelujah. I used even the people, amen, that did what they did to you to bring you to where you are in me and to make you what you are. This is where I've attracted my anointing and my oil to your life. You've got to celebrate them. Don't just tolerate, amen, that they were a part of your life. And wish God, I wish this or wish. No, God said, just maybe. I allowed it, though I didn't offer it, but I allowed the hurt. Luke 10:19 said, behold, look at your neighbor and say, look here. Behold means don't just read, don't just hear this stuff, see it. Lift your hands and say, God, open the eyes of my understanding. Ephesians 1. Amen. Verse 19. Amen. He said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents, on scorpions, and over all powers of the enemy, and nothing shall bind and means hurt you. God said, I give you power to walk on and power to walk over. Come on, somebody say, walk on and walk over. That's what the anointing is here tonight to do in somebody that'll receive this word of forgiveness. God said, I'm going to give you the power to walk on and get over them. Look at your neighbor and say, I feel like I'm about to get over somebody tonight. I'm about to get over. And listen to what he said. Nothing. Somebody say, nothing shall bind and means hurt you. I'm telling you tonight, this that has hurt you so long will not hurt. It will not hurt no more after tonight if you respond to the power and the words of the Holy Ghost. Somebody lift your hands and say, there's a place tonight in this altar when I forgive them that I won't hurt no more. I may still remember what they did, but it won't hurt no more. It won't hurt no more.
Listen to what the Word of God says in Luke 19. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree because the Lord, he wanted to see. I remember learning that in Sunday school. As a little boy, was a wee little man. He was a wee little man in stature, but he was a big man financially. Come on, somebody. I was about to say he's a Republican, but I mean he was a publican. Come on, somebody. He was a tax collector, and he always charged more than he was supposed to. He got wealthy off of poor people. And I'm telling you, everybody hated him. Even though he was a Jew, man, he was hated worse even by them. And people had all against him because of the way he dealt that system of the Romans to his even on his own people to get rich off of them. Oh, but he heard about Jesus, and his sins were many. He felt convicted and guilty of them. Hallelujah. And one day he wanted to see Jesus, and there was a crowd around Jesus, and he couldn't get to them. Couldn't get to Jesus for the press or the crowd. Hallelujah. Amen. But listen what happened. The Bible said he run ahead of the people and he climbed up in that sycamore tree. Hallelujah. He said, because the Lord's passing by today and I got to see him. Hallelujah. When Jesus walked by and saw this man, come on somebody, with that kind of garments that he had on, what rich men would wear. Hallelujah. Everybody I can imagine is looking at old Zacchaeus, making fun of him, said, that's an old, amen, thief. Look at him, that dummy. He done lost his mind. They're laughing at him, pointing their fingers at him. Jesus stops through that big old metropolis city of Jericho. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm talking about a metropolis city like Atlanta, Georgia. Jesus done walked all day through the city and hadn't stopped one time. A Jesus parade. But he ain't stopped one time. Hallelujah. But one little old short man, one man that's full of sin. Come on, somebody. Couldn't get to Jesus for all the people. Amen. He was so desperate for forgiveness and mercy that he climbed up in a tree. And Jesus stopped and said, Zacchaeus, verse 10 of Luke 19, make haste. Hurry, son. Come down, for I'm going to your house today. He told one man out of crowds, I'm going to your house. Why? Because his heart was broken and it was repented. But listen what he did to get to Jesus. Somebody shout, he got into Jesus. But somebody shout, he first had to get over the people. Whew. Somebody shout, if you don't get over the people, you can't get into Jesus. Hallelujah. Your worst enemy, you'll find out, won't be devils. It'll be whom devils use. It'll be people. But look at your neighbors. They don't take it personally, because you're not fighting personalities. You're fighting principalities. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness in high places, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? And let me tell you something about them devils. Glory to God at the cross. According to Colossians 2:15, God said that Jesus on that cross spoiled every one of them principalities openly. Spoiled them. Rendered them defeated. Somebody say spoiled them. Whoa, they done rotten and stinking. They defeated, they laying dead. Somebody shout, the devil ain't losing. He's already lost. He lost at the cross. Somebody shout, that's where your victory is tonight. It's at the foot of this holy, bloody tree where Jesus shouts out, forgive them. They don't know what they do. And if you'll visit that tree with me tonight, hallelujah, glory to God, you'll be able to receive a faith and a power from another world, from your heart. Hallelujah, you'll be able to say, Father, have a gift. Look at your neighbor and say, get over the people. Get into Jesus. I quit studying people over 25 years ago. Because the devil makes sure all the time he's going to send people. He's going to send people. Say, you need Saul's armor on. You need to fit the cookie cutter image of what ministry's like. You need to be like us. And just like us. You got to do it like we do, or it ain't God. Real leaders who are spiritual, they can see there's people among them that ain't going to do it like them. They can see that you're different. Look at your neighbor and say, thank God we're not the same.
One Marvin's enough. Come on, somebody. One Michael's enough. And your wife said amen about twice. Hey, man, take my fingerprint. Come on, somebody. Ain't nobody got nothing like it. Look at your neighbor and say, he from South Georgia, ain't got nothing like it.
I mean, one time somebody told me, he said, if you're going to be used by God, you need to learn to change the way you talk in your delivery of your message, that you pronounce your words very clear and that you speak them.
I was in Texas one time, and the pastor was introducing people from different countries, and he was talking about their accent. He said, now our guest speaker this morning, he also has an accent. I'm going to let him speak for himself, and we'll see if you can guess where he's from. I'm going to take a shortcut. That all right, Joe? Hallelujah. I put my Bible up on the pulpit. I just kind of cocked my hip out like that right there. Propped my elbow up like that. I said, how y'all doing? Hallelujah. Some of them thought I was from Kentucky. I've literally been told that before. If you want God to use you widely and greater, it's almost like you need to get in front of the mirror and practice. I've heard some of them, they'll be just talking like me. All of a sudden, somebody of importance, quote unquote, on the phone. All of a sudden, I'm going to be me. Saul's armor don't fit. I've tried it before. I ain't proved it. I ain't tested it. Weighed me down. Come on, somebody. They told me I had to be like this and I had to be like that. But the Holy Ghost just told me, except this is that. Let me anoint you. I didn't anoint you to be like nobody else. I anointed you to be you. Be yourself. I'm the one that made you. I put you together. That don't mean, glory to God, you can't grow in the Lord. And come on, somebody. But I'm going to take my smooth stones. And I'm going to take my old winding up sling that kind of roars every now and then. Come on, somebody. Causing me to... Hallelujah. I'm going to slay giants with it. Come on, somebody. I was told one time you need to quit saying, come on, somebody. I said, I will when somebody comes on. Or no, I did. I said, when everybody comes on. Get over people. Get into Jesus. Somebody say, get over the people. Get in to Jesus. Let me tell you what's happening. Because Jesus said, they don't know what they do, but I forgive them. Why? Because he knew why. He knew what they were doing. Let me show it to you this way. Man, I feel the glory of the Lord, Pastor. Not just the presence or power of God. I feel his glory. I feel his approval. Listen, in Psalms 118, 22, 23, and 24, David, who is a prophet according to Acts 2 and 30, he wasn't just a king, he was a prophet. And listen what he said. As he looks through the telescope of time, this is a messianic passage. One of the scriptures I'll quote in the last one is very familiar. The church sings about it, quotes it all the time. But listen what Psalms 118, 22, and 23, and 24 says. It says, the stone which the builders have rejected has become the headstone of the corner, or the cornerstone. He said, this is the Lord's doings, and it's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Boy, we like to dance around. This is the day that the Lord has made. And we think he's talking about today. He didn't say today, he said this day.
What is this day? It's that day that the religious rulers rejected Jesus, the day that they cried out, "Crucify him. He's full of Beelzebub. He's possessed with the devil. He casts out devils by devils." Hallelujah. They rejected him. Come on, somebody. They crucified him on the cross. But David said, it weren't the devil's doings. It was the Lord's doings. And he said, when we get this revelation, it was a miracle. It's marvelous in our eyes. What day? Not just today. This day. This day that the religious rulers, come on, rejected the Messiah and he was crucified on the cross. For without it, you, neither I, could be saved. That's why David said, it's marvelous. What is the day he was rejected? The day he was betrayed, the day he was ridiculed, the day he was beaten, the day he was crucified. Come on, somebody, on that cross, somebody shout, this meant God had to use enemies. God had to use religious folk. I didn't say people with a relationship with God. I'm talking about religious folks that thought they knew God. Because if they'd have knew God, come on, somebody, they wouldn't have been trying to kill him. Anybody, they didn't even recognize him. They didn't know who he was. But Jesus did. He said they don't know what they're doing. Because 1 Corinthians 2, hallelujah, 15 said, if the princes of this world would have knew him as the King of glory, they wouldn't have crucified him. They didn't know what they were doing. But Jesus said, I do. Without them, there would be no salvation. Next time you read about the Pharisees in the Bible, you'll just stop and take a praise break and say, thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you for them. I'm trying to teach you, when the enemies come against you, come on, somebody, when the day of rejection comes, let it be marvelous in your eyes. Stop letting it hurt you. Stop letting it grieve you. And allow the glory of God to come and rejoice in it, because this is the day that the Lord hath made. What day? That day of rejection. That day they crucified him. And if you're in that day, let it be this day. Come on, somebody. Glory in the cross. Glory in the attack. Glory when the enemy comes against you. Why? Because the Spirit, glory to God of his glory, amen, is resting upon you. Shout his praise. Somebody stop and praise break right now and thank him for an enemy. Thank him for an attack. Thank him for everything that's ever been sent by the adversary against you. Listen, I'm about through. I try not to start. So I pray, Holy Ghost, you take it. Glory to God. In Judges 14:5, a young lion roared against Samson. Somebody say, young lion. Ain't talking about some old toothless lion wore out. Amen. He didn't have no roar. He sounded like a tomcat. Meow. I ain't talking about one of them lions. I'm talking about a young lion, strong, mean, roaring against Samson. And the Bible said Samson had the Holy Ghost come on him. Spirit of God came mightily on him. And he took that young lion in his hands and tore that lion. Can you picture this? Look at your neighbor and say, I know it is ridiculous, but it's miraculous. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, it's in your Bible? Praise God. You want some action? Look in the Bible, son. I'm telling you, it's full of it. He took that lion in his hands and pulled it apart like you would do a young lamb. I don't know about you. I couldn't even pull no young lamb apart, much less a lion. Now I could pull me some lamb chops apart, especially after this Daniel fast. So, come on, somebody. But he pulled that thing. He rent him, the Bible said. Ripped that lion into pieces with his bare hand after the Holy Ghost come on him. Delilah tried to find where his strength was. And she eventually did.
He's a Nazarite. It was his long hair. That was his secret. Come on. So if he was a man with big muscles, they would immediately said, that's where his strength is. I believe he's just like me and you, friend. Come on. And that ain't a disgrace to you. Amen. Because we ain't little either. Hello? My muscle's bigger right here than anywhere. Archbishop, praise God. Hallelujah. But I don't believe he looked like Arnold Schwarzenegger. Come on, somebody. I don't believe he was all buffed and puffed up. Amen. Walking out. Want some of me lying? Bring it on. Come on. No, he was just as common as anybody else. But when the lion roared, the Holy Ghost soared. When the lion roared against him, the Holy Ghost came mightily on him. Anything Samson did, it was after an enemy attacked him and God anointed him. Somebody shout, the attack is what anoints us. It's what the enemy sends to attack us with. That's where the anointing comes from. Look at your neighbor. Say, when the lion roars, just go ahead and praise God, because that means the Spirit of God's about to soar. He's about to take you to a level in his power you've never gone. God always lets the lion proceed with a roar before the anointing is increased. Then in Judges 15, boy, I'm hitting spirits while I'm preaching. I can feel it. The sword of the Spirit of God in my mouth is hitting spirits right now. God shut lions' mouths since I'm speaking of a lion. And listen to this. Because the lion's a spirit, according to 2 Timothy, amen, 4:17. Because Paul said he has shut the lion's mouth. You didn't see Paul, amen, wrestling lions literally like Daniel did in Daniel 6. He was talking about a spirit. Hallelujah. And he said, my God, shut the lion's mouth. And it was a lion roaring, a spirit roaring through people. Because he said, at first no man stood with me, and they all turned against me. But notwithstanding this, the Lord stood with me and has strengthened me. Somebody shout, anointed me mightily. Amen. That the preaching might be fully known with full grace, full power. Come on, somebody, to Gentiles so they can be saved. And it shut the lion's mouth. I believe God shut the lion's mouth for old Samson. Killed that thing. Then in Judges 15, verse 14, about 1,000 Philistines came against him. And the Bible said they shouted against him. They shouted, I don't know what they shouted out, but they shouted out probably something like, we're about to kill you. We're about to stop you. We're about to destroy you. Woe unto them that shout out against the Spirit of God and his work and say, we're about to stop you and we're about to cause you to cease. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost, when the Philistines, when the enemy's voices heard shouting out against you, that's when you need to stand your ground. Don't run, don't retreat, because the Spirit of God came mighty on Samson when the Philistines shouted against him and he slay them all with the jawbone of a donkey. And the church said, hee-haw. Somebody shout, he destroyed them enemies with a jaw. Look at your neighbor and say, how you jawing? No, we in Southeast Georgia, jawing means how you start talking, hey? What you saying? Isaiah 54, verse 16 said, behold, somebody say, see it. Behold, I've created the smith that bloweth on the fire, that he forth an instrument of work for his hands. And he says, I have created the waster to waste. But verse 17 of Isaiah 54 said, no weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against you in judgment, you shall condemn. You shall judge it with your words. You shall call judgment from your mouth. Come on, so, for this is the heritage of the Lord, and that righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Tonight I come with a spiritual jaw. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. And God says you need to get it in your spirit too. You need to open your mouth. And God says, whatever the enemy's formed against you, condemn it. I condemn every voice. I condemn every line that's come against you and that's come against what God's called you to do. I condemn it. I judge it, for the spiritual judge all things. 1 Corinthians 2:15, in the name of Jesus, and I call things that are not as though they were.
Romans 4:17. Listen to this. God said in Isaiah 54:16 again, he said, I am the one that created the smith, the blow on the fire. That blacksmith to take that raw iron, heat it up until it bends, and then beats it. Beats it. Forming an instrument, a weapon. God says, also, by the way, I created the waster to waste. I created the destroyer to destroy. Somebody say, God created the smith, the enemy. God created the enemy to bring the fire. Come on, somebody, to send that fiery trial and to bring that stuff. Come on, and all those weapons he's forming with the fire. That's meant to kill you with, to stop you with, to make you cease, to take you out with. God says, behold, I made the destroyer. Somebody say, the devil, to come and destroy. I'm the one that permitted him. I created him. But God goes on to say in verse 17 again of Isaiah 54, no weapon. Somebody shout, that means no weapon. That means every weapon this devil has been permitted of God to make as a weapon against you, to stop you, to destroy you, to defeat you, to render you defeated. God said it will not prosper. Somebody shouting, if the enemy's weapon won't prosper, that means hallelujah, I will. That means whatever the devil has formed against you as a weapon, it won't prosper, but it'll make you prosper. I found out when the enemy's forming stuff against me, that's what prospers me. Talk on, devil. Roar on lines. Roar on, talk on, speak on. You ain't no match for this Holy Ghost. You ain't no match for this anointing. All you're doing is advertising for me. Go ahead and advertise, you devil, for the Lord shall shut your mouth when he's through with you. Oh, glory. Somebody shout, it's the lions roaring and the enemy shouting. That's what brings his oil. That's what anoints you. That's what brings his power on your life. So look at your neighbor and say, when the mad come, don't join them. Don't return the madness. Rejoice. When they ridicule you, rejoice. When they speak all manner against you, give him glory. When people hurt you and when they do things to you, understand, though they don't know what they do, you should by now. Somebody shout, they're anointing me. They're getting me ready to be used of God. If you'll forgive them and get over them people like Zacchaeus and get into Jesus, God said, I'll trust you with the oil I can't trust others with. Hello? Luke 6:46 says, woe unto you when all men speak well of you, for so did your fathers, the false prophets before them. Let me tell you what a false prophet is. It's not necessarily somebody that gives a wrong prophecy. Samuel missed God. He was an authentic prophet of God. God said his words never failed the ground. Hello? But in 1 Samuel 16, he missed God on probably one of the biggest important assignments he ever had. He looked at Eliab, Jesse's eldest son, and said, surely this is the anointed. God rebuked him and said, I don't look on the outer appearance like man does. I look on the heart. You just missed me. But he was still God's prophet. Hello? Tell you what a false prophet is. False prophet's somebody who, after they get through prophesying, everybody likes them. Somebody say, you might be a false prophet if everybody's got something well to say about you after you get through saying, thus saith the Lord. False prophets tell you what you want to hear rather than what you need to hear. They'll prophesy to you about how God's going to bless you financially and you don't even tithe. Devil is a liar. I cast the devil out of a man through the name of Jesus one night in Alma, Georgia, years ago, up under my tent. When I had a tent. Thank God you delivered me from that tent, Lord. I knew it was for a season, but I still have aches today from that tent.
But I remember that night, a young guy in a three-piece suit sit about on the third row out there. And I'd try to preach, and every time Pastor Jamie Wild would be trying to preach, he'd go speaking in tongues. He's interrupting me. Somebody shout, the Holy Ghost don't interrupt himself to say what he's already said. He does things in decency and order. Come on, church. And don't get me wrong, it's never out of order to let the gifts of the Spirit move. But demons drive you, Holy Ghost leads you. If you meet people that say, oh, I couldn't stop, I couldn't help myself because the Holy Ghost was in control, look at them and say, witchcraft got a hold of you. Holy Ghost don't overpower you. He empowers you. He leads you. As many are led by the Spirit, they're children of God. Romans 8. Amen. Verses 14. Holy Ghost don't push you. He don't make you. Holy Ghost never comes on your life and makes you do something against your will he's gave you. If you're forced to do it and you have no power to say yes or no, somebody shout, that's the devil. And if you got to speak in tongues while the preacher's preaching, somebody shout, that's the flesh. But if you keep on after a while, it might be a devil. Because the Holy Ghost don't have to interrupt himself to say what he's already saying. I couldn't even preach. Every time I'd open my mouth, finally I stopped and I said, young brother, sit down. You're out of order. I said, you're interrupting the Holy Ghost. I said, the Holy Ghost ain't going to interrupt me quoting a scripture in the middle of a scripture, amen, to give out a message. I said, the message is the written word to begin with. Come on, somebody. Period. There'll be a pause that's divine. There'll be a room somewhere that's made. Come on, somebody. In order. And I said, every time I try to open my mouth, they can't hear me over the sound system because you keep hollering out in tongues. I said, your tongue ain't of the Holy Ghost. Get still. In defiance, I tried to preach again, and he started doing it again. The Holy Ghost told me right then, he said, this ain't flesh, this is a spirit. And when he told me it was a spirit, I remember I walked down, come on, sister, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Hallelujah. I walked down, amen, and I got in front of him right there, and he was still shouting out, speaking in tongues. He was already jerking and come on, jolting, come on, man. He was kicking up the grass and in the dirt, son. He was having him appeared to be a time. And when I stepped up in front of him, he went from speaking in tongues, and he stopped and looked at me, and his eyes changed, got all beady looking, and he went to growling at me, and then he hit the ground. He went to flouncing around like a fish out of water, slithering at times like a snake. Come on, somebody. Look at your neighbor and say, church was off the chain right then, son. Glory. Ain't nothing like a devil manifesting to get folks in an altar start repenting. Folks start hitting the altar, talking about, oh, Jesus, God, anything in me, Lord. Oh, Lord. Some folks left. Oh, that's all you need on a Sunday morning when the house is full. It's just one devil to manifest. Bring it on, Jesus. I like it. Hallelujah. Listen, that devil manifested in a three-piece suit. After having spoken tongues, and he's walling around on the ground. Pastor Calvin, I don't know if you remember or not, but I believe y'all let me use the chairs from the church when I did this revival I'm talking about. Hallelujah. And man, that devil, he was flouncing around out there. And I had a couple guys, I said, stand him up. He ain't fitting to wallow around and fall down like he's in the Holy Ghost. That ain't the Holy Ghost. I said, get him up. Stand him up. Hallelujah. And I wouldn't let him fall down until the Holy Ghost said it was time to. Amen. And eventually when he hit the ground, when the Lord said it was time, hallelujah, them devils come out of him leaving and screaming. Come on, church. And I'll never forget what God told me. I looked up and I said, God said he received this demon. He got demon possessed at the church he goes to. Right then I emptied one whole row. Because I didn't know he was with his pastor in his church. Needs to say they were gone and I was surely a false prophet. Hello? But he got delivered. I saw him 2 years later in a revival. He come up to me with tears in his eyes. You can see the glory of God on his countenance. I didn't even remember who he was. He didn't even look the same, literally. And he told me who he was. And he said, Brother Marvin, I was that young man that the Holy Ghost used you to cast the devil out of that night under that tent. I said, yeah, man, I remember that. He said, what was so strange, I didn't even know I was demon-possessed. He said, but the Holy Ghost knew how I was living. He said, I'd go to church, I'd prophesy to everybody. They'd let me preach. I had charisma in my delivery when I'd tell people stuff. I told them what they wanted to hear. He said, but I was indulging in pornography. Amen. When I was at home, I was doing stuff that nobody knew about in secret. I had so many secret sins, living in all that filth. But yet I had tongues at church and prophecies to follow. And folks was shouting over it and falling out over it. And I was deceived and being deceived. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Deceiving and being deceived, he said. He said, but that night I got saved. That night I got free. He said, now I'm really preaching. Hallelujah. And I'm living what he tells me to preach. I'm not just prophesying. Somebody shout, that's a false prophet.
So everybody liked him. But that night, Holy Ghost pulled his cards and set him free. Somebody say, whoa, when everybody likes what you gotta say. That might be the sign you ain't authentic. Holy Ghost, all I care is that you like me. That you say after I have finished, well, did Marvin say. Lord, tonight there's somebody here who's lived a life of wounds. They got so many scars and they just keep opening over and over and over. They were so wounded, some of them, Lord God, some 15, 20, 25 years ago. Some even further back than that. But tonight I prophesy they will conquer their past. They will get past this past and they'll do it at the cross. Seeing Jesus, say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And tonight at your cross on this tree, they'll get over the people that hurt them, and they'll release them. And when they do, your miraculous touch shall come from heaven. And what has kept the heavens brass and what has kept your promises held back in their life shall issue forth and come forth as suddenly from your presence. They will see things that otherwise they won't be able to see. Come on, lift your hands in his presence. He heals the broken in heart and he binds up their wounds. Psalms 147:3. Well, how does he heal it? I take my heart to the cross and I see Jesus forgiving me of my sins there. And I lay my heart down at the foot of his cross. And I say, Jesus, because you forgave me by faith, I forgive them. They don't know what they're doing, but I do now. They're anointing me. They're welcoming your Holy Ghost to my life to be used by you like I've never been used. So I'm not going to let the abuse use me no more. I'm going to let the anointing use me. I'm going to forgive them and let them go. By faith. In Matthew 18, there was a man who owed a great king a great debt. He owed a big payment that he couldn't pay. And when that man begged for mercy, that king forgave his debt, wiped it clean, and let him go. And that same man that was forgiven went to somebody that owed him a small debt, had him locked up in prison, and would not forgive him. When that great king heard of this, about the man he had forgiven of such a great debt that couldn't forgive somebody that owed him such a small debt, he was wroth, he was mad, he was angry. He said, I changed my mind. All that I forgave him, I take it back. Go put him in prison and turn him over to tormentors. This is in Matthew 18. Somebody say tormentors. Let's go ahead and get in the spirit about it. Tormentors are demons. They're devils. If you don't forgive people, you are turning yourself over to devils. Ephesians 4:26 said, be ye angry and sin not. Come on. Verse 27, neither let the sun go down upon your wrath. Somebody shout, if you go to bed angry, if you go to bed with hatred, you're going to wake up with a devil. Come on, somebody. And anger ain't but one letter away from danger. Just put a D in front of it. It ain't wrong to be angry, but God said, don't sin. Here's how he said, don't sin. Before you go to bed, before that sun sets, you better release whoever it is. Let them go. Somebody tonight, the person you need to forgive is yourself. That's the reason you keep going back to the same sins you repent over and you backslide all over again, because somehow you can't get close enough to this cross to understand that Jesus has forgiven you. And now, because your conscience is still so guilty and you can't release yourself though he's forgiven you, hallelujah, you can't serve the living God until your dead conscience gets purged. Come on, according to Hebrews 9:14. And I want you to know the blood of Jesus don't just forgive your sin. Hallelujah, according to Ephesians 1:7. 1 John 1:7 said the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all our sin. Friend, when you do me wrong, I can forgive you, but I can't cleanse you of the wrong. But Jesus is different. He's God. He not only can forgive you, but he can cleanse you of the sin. And he'll say, your sins and iniquities I'll remember no more. Hebrews 10:17. Surely if Jesus can forgive you, by faith you ought to come to his cross tonight and forgive yourself. In Matthew 19, after Jesus taught in Matthew 18 about if you don't forgive, I won't forgive you, I'll turn you over to tormentors. Matthew 19:1-2, the multitudes that he was teaching this to still following him. The Bible said he turned around and he healed every one of them. I won't forget, in 1999, I was in Moultrie, Georgia. I was preaching on television, on satellite television. There it was local. They said, we want you to come do an hour healing service. And that night, the Holy Ghost told me to preach the cross, and he said, I want you to preach how I forgave. I said, Lord, what's that got to do with healing? He said, everything. And he started showing me then some of what I'm preaching right now. And I preached Matthew 18 and the first part of Matthew 19. And I said, some of you, you can have all the faith in the world you want. Come on, you can be anointed with so much oil and get in every healing line. You look like a greasy pig at a county fair. You've been anointed so much. Come on, but you're not going to be healed until you get that hatred out of your heart at the foot of his cross and forgive those that have hurt you by faith, because Jesus forgave you. You forgive them and you do it by faith. I preached that night. That 1 hour healing service turned into a 3 hour service. The phone lines, and they had about 10 to 12 lines, I think. Amen. They were jammed the whole 3 hours. People calling in, talking about their healing. I won't never forget the first lady that called in. She called in and she was shouting and screaming. And she said, I have been prayed for years. I've been anointed with oil. Hallelujah. I've been obeying God to the best of my ability. She said, but I've had so many back surgeries. I can barely stand. I can barely walk. I can barely move. She said, but when you were preaching this about forgiveness tonight, hallelujah, and how Jesus forgave us, she said, it was like a shaft of light come down in my soul and said, that's what you've been missing. She said, and by faith from my heart I cried out to the Christ who forgave me on that cross, and by what he did I say it too, I forgive them, they don't know what they do. Hallelujah. She said, it felt like hot oil run down my back. She said, those that's with me in my living room had to remove the coffee table to the side of the wall, because I ain't been able to stop dancing and shouting only long enough to stop and call. She said, I was healed instantly. Tonight, there's a healing that goes deeper than your emotions. There's a healing that'll go even into your flesh. Somebody shout when you let them go. At the foot of his cross. Hallelujah. Who is that person that you can still remember? You remember them real quick. It ain't hard. You don't have to guess. Right up in front of you do they come. Maybe like me over that dirty dishwater. Maybe you think you've let them go. Come on, this person may be dead and left this earth already. It still ain't too late for you. If you want God's touch on your life, if you really want him to use you, if you really want to be able to receive what it is all he wants to do in you and through you, you better be heard tonight by faith saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Come on, I'm the newspaper boy. I'm not the message, I'm only the messenger. I've laid it on your doorstep, doorsteps of your heart tonight. Will you pick it up? Will you download? Will you receive the divine text of the Lord? Will you reply to it? Will you pick up and answer? You let him heal the hurt tonight. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents, on scorpions, and of all powers of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you, Luke 10:19. See, we're more attracted to services where the preacher just skims the surface of the heart. And I go ahead and prophesy our miracle and declare what God's about to do for us. Thank God for a pastor who prayed two nights ago and says God wants to do something in the heart. Somebody say in the heart. It's an inside job tonight. For the Holy Ghost can do things for you and through you. He must do it in you. Will you let him? He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice, will open the door, I'll come in. He don't want to stand on the outside. He wants to come in. He said, so I can sup with you and you with me. Revelation 3:20. Don't you hear him knocking tonight? God says, take me to that place. In John chapter 11, Jesus told Martha and Mary and all those grieving people at Lazarus' tomb, he said, take me where you've laid him. Somebody tonight, you need to take Jesus where you've gave up. You need to take Jesus to that place where you grieve the most, where you've been hurt the most. Come on, take him. He knows how to step back into the past. Come on, somebody. He's omnipresent. That don't mean he's everywhere in the present. That means he's everywhere in time. All time is present knowledge to God. Past, present, and future. He ain't on his way nowhere. He's everywhere, including yesterday. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's too big for time. It's the immensity of God. He's everywhere. He's so mighty. He's the only time traveler I know. He can go all the way back to the past. He can go all the way back to that moment you were hurt and heal you from the inside out. Brianna, play that song on that soundtrack. No offense to you, brother. Just stay right there because I'll use you in just a moment. But I want this soundtrack to play. I've come to worship you. Put it on whatever light lights up there, Sister Connie. I know you. We don't know where that is. But just make sure I got some volume with it because my voice is still pretty shot. Ma'am, I want you to stand right here for a minute, will you? Because God's going to heal you. Lift your hands. Psalms 127 and 2 said he gives his beloved sleep. You're going to be able to sleep. He ain't been able to sleep in a long time. Hallelujah, but you're going to rest tonight, for his presence will go with you and you'll have rest. Exodus 33:14. Give me a man with a strong back. Come here and help me. Come on, let the Holy Ghost use you tonight. Holy Ghost, I thank you right now in Jesus' mighty name. Touch! Hallelujah! Thank you, God. God says it is stayed at my altar. You've left it here. It will not go with you no more. Leave it there. Leave it there. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. If you'll trust and never doubt, he'll surely bring you out. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. Whoa! Leave it there. Come on, sing it if you know it. Leave it there. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. If you'll trust and never doubt, he will surely bring you out. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave it there. 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. Psalms 55:22 says, cast your burden upon the Lord and he'll sustain you. He'll preserve you. He won't allow you, the righteous, to be moved. That word burden in Hebrew means the gift. Somebody shout, cast the gift. Somebody say, the burden. What you don't realize, the thing that burdens you down, if you'll bring it to him and lay it at his feet, it will become a gift.
Yes, thank you.
That the enemy has sent to attack you will become an anointing, a gift.